Hello everyone. Let's discuss with the geopolitics of Afghanistan. The topic of paper 2, Paul Science. Afghan peace process is in the news also. So let's try to understand the dynamics of Afghanistan. There are too much of complexities involved within this particular issue. So let's try to understand these things in detail. First, what we are going to discuss in this particular video is the geopolitics of Afghanistan. When we say the geopolitics of Afghanistan, means who all are the different stakeholders who have their interests involved in this region. So the different stakeholders whose interest involved in this region are US, Russia, Pakistan, India, China, Iran, and Afghans. So from this thing itself, we can understand as there are too many stakeholders who are involved in this region, that's why this political, so much of political instability prevails. There are too many, every player has its own interest. All are trying to achieve their interest through different means. One of the main reasons for the kind of political instability which prevails in this region. Okay, so second thing we are going to discuss is why so much of instability? What are the interests of these players within Afghanistan? Why Afghanistan is called as graveyard of empires? Might be few of you have heard that Afghanistan is called graveyard. Why it is called as graveyard of empires? What is the reason? What is the difference between Taliban and Al-Qaeda? Most of the students think that both are the same organizations having same objectives to achieve. Both have different objectives to achieve. So what exactly, what is the thin line difference between Taliban and Al-Qaeda? Both are aspiring to achieve different objectives in the world. What are India's interests in this region? What is the difference between good Taliban and bad Taliban? And why the rising presence of Islamic State in Afghanistan itself is a threat for Taliban? So what led to the rise of ISIS is beyond the ambit of our discussion, at least for this class. So I'm not going to discuss what led to the emergence of ISIS. I tell you the objective of Islamic State and why the rising presence of ISIS is itself a threat for Afghans, especially Taliban. So all these things we are going to discuss in detail in this particular video. So before I'll go further, so first try to understand where lies Afghanistan. So when we say geographically, Afghan lies in which part of the world? So Afghanistan beyond doubt is in Asia, but in which part of Asia? Afghanistan is at the crossroads of West Asia, Central Asia, South Asia. So it is at the crossroads. As you can see, Afghan lies along the tri-junction of Iran, Pakistan, and Central Asian states. Because of its location, one of the main reasons for the political instability is its geography itself. Okay. Now, as I said, Afghanistan lies at the crossroads of West Asia, Central Asia, and South Asia. Now, who consider itself as a bigger player of South Asia? Beyond doubt, India. As India considers itself as a bigger player, India wants to keep its depth intact in this region. When we say depth, it means political. When we say depth, depth means to have our political say in this region, to have pro-Indian government in this region, okay, to have our influence in this region. How we can have our influence in Afghan? Only when the government of Afghanistan is pro-India. So India considers South Asia as its sphere of influence and we want to have our political depth intact here. So India considers Afghan as its sphere of influence. Russia considers Afghan as its extended backyard. So Russia wants to maintain its presence here. The reason why Soviet invaded Afghanistan way back in 79. The strong regional player of West Asia, Iran. Shia majority, Iran wants to have its depth intact here. Okay, now China's ambitions are on rise and China wants to have its depth here. Pakistan consider Afghan as its backyard. So Pakistan wants to maintain its influence here. So as different players wants to keep their influence intact, the reason, as I earlier said, the reason because of the so many stakeholders who are involved in the process is one of the main reason for the political instability of Afghanistan. Okay, so geography, one of the reason. Okay. Political instability is nothing new for Afghanistan. it goes way back into the history when the great game started in this region, between whom Britain, British Empire, Indian Pakistan was a part of British Empire, and between the Russian Tsar, autocratic ruler of Russia. So the great game took place in Afghanistan. I hope those who have read the medieval history that Britain fought three Anglo-Afghan wars. These wars were to have their political control over Afghanistan. Okay, but Britain failed to bring Afghan under their political control. Okay, only country in this region who protected their independence or sovereignty was Afghanistan. Afghan was never under the control of any political empire till date. Completely, all empires have failed to completely control Afghanistan. British, one of the strongest empire, failed to bring Afghan under their political control. Though great game took place between Tsar, because British had the threat that Tsar can increase its influence here, which will bring what the Indian Empire of British under threat. So they wanted to bring Afghan under their control to create it as a buffer against the Tsar, but they failed. So Britain failed to do that. Then Soviet, USSR wanted to spread the influence of communism or wanted to protect the communist government of Afghanistan, the reason why Soviet invaded in Afghanistan. But Soviet left in 1890. In 10 years, Soviet failed to bring Afghan under their control. Okay. So there are so many reasons we'll discuss. And the biggest reason was that US created Taliban with the help of Pakistan. We'll come back to this thing within a few minutes. So Soviet failed to bring Afghan under their control. One of the reasons for the disintegration of Soviet Union was the Afghan misadventure. It proved costly for the Soviet Empire, this invasion in Afghanistan. Okay, so Soviet failed way back and led to the disintegration of Soviet Union. Now, since 2001, US is fighting in Afghanistan against the Taliban. Okay, just a few minutes back I said Taliban was created by US. So when US created Taliban, how come the dynamics change that US has to wage a war against Taliban itself? We'll discuss that also. So 2001, US invaded Afghanistan and started a global war against terror, or started a war against the government of Taliban or against the regime of Taliban. But now it is 2020. Even after 19 years, US has failed to defeat Taliban. In fact, US is desperate for withdrawal. Okay, as US is desperate for withdrawal, because US understand this war has started hurting US back itself. It is hurting the economy of US. The reason why Afghanistan is called as the graveyard of empires. No empire, superpower failed to defeat Afghan. Soviet Empire failed to defeat Afghan. Britain failed to defeat Afghan. The reason why Afghan is called a graveyard, US has understood this thing. If I'll keep my presence intact, if I'll further involve myself in this geopolitics, might be I'm going to dig my own graveyard in this region. The reason why US is desperate for withdrawal. And Trump has made this as one of the issue. And this is going to be one of the issue in the US elections. That is the withdrawal from Afghanistan. So right now, US is desperate for withdrawal, but US wants to project, because US needs to save its face. US entered here with the objective of what? Defeat of Taliban and install a democracy in Afghan. But right now, US is ready to transfer power in the hands of Taliban. So it will be difficult for US to justify its intervention here, because US is a democracy and US needs to justify it to its own population what we have achieved in last 19 years. So right now US is under a lot of pressure, because US needs to project that we have installed a democracy in Afghanistan, though this is looking bleak. So if US will vacate today without bringing peace, stability, and again Taliban will come back into power, it will be a blot on US diplomacy. Okay, so all these things are going on within Afghanistan, the reason why Afghan is called as the graveyard of empires. Okay, I'll not go back too much into the history now. Now I'll tell you what are the interests of India in this region, what India is looking forward to, and why our Afghan policy somehow India's influence is reducing in this region, and influence of Pakistan is increasing again in this region. So how these tables turned, let's discuss that particular aspect. In short, what are the interests of India and Afghan? One, peace and stability. We want peace and stability in our backyard, because if instability will increase, it can serve the interest of Islamic extremists, which can push further this extremism within India, because the camps of Lashkar, Jaish and Hizbul are located within POK. So if Islamic extremism will increase in this region, this can increase violent Islamic extremism in India. So India wants peace and stability. India wants democracy, and India wants pro-Indian government within Afghanistan, because India is looking for resources from Central Asia, and we do not have direct access to Central Asia. Only land route to reach Central Asia is through Afghanistan or Pakistan. Tense ties with Pakistan, and if anti-Indian government will come in Afghanistan, India's Central Asian policy, it will going to impact India's influence in Central Asia. Okay, so India is looking for what? Access from Afghanistan to Central Asia. Okay, and here lies the importance of Iran also, because we do not have direct access to Afghanistan also. Only way to reach Afghanistan is through Iran. That's why Chabahar is strategically very important. From Iran, we want to reach to Afghanistan, and from Afghanistan, we want to reach to Central Asia, which is a resource-rich region, and Central Asia is also important as a market for India. Now, who wants to cut down India's influence in Central Asia? China. That's why China wants Pakistan to have more influence and control in Afghanistan. Okay? But US wants India to have its presence intact. After the withdrawal of NATO, there will be a vacuum, and US wants, who should fill this vacuum? India. So this is what exactly is going on presently in this region. Okay. Now I'll start my discussion from the Soviet invasion 1979. As I said, the Soviet Empire considers this region as its extended backyard. So the communist government was under the threat. To protect the communist government of Afghanistan, Soviet invaded in 1979. Okay, at that time Cold War was going on, and US was pursuing the policy of containment of communism. US created Taliban. So Taliban as a group was created by US with the help of Pakistan. Okay, so US gave a lot of funding and weapons to the army of Pakistan to create Taliban, okay, on the name of jihad, that you have to fight against foreign aggression who is trying to bring your territory under their control. So the fighters of Taliban fought against the Soviet forces. Okay, now Taliban is a political grouping whose objective is to acquire the political control of Afghanistan. This is the sole objective of Taliban, to have a political control of Afghanistan and govern Afghanistan through Islamic constitution, through the laws of Sharia. And they want their constitution to be constituted by Islamic scholars. So they do not have a trust on democracy. They don't want secular constitution. They want Islamic constitution, and they want to impose their version of Islam on everyone who is living within Afghan. So Taliban is a Islamic fundamentalist group. Okay. Al-Qaeda is a terrorist group whose objective is to revenge. So there is a lot of difference between these two groups, Taliban and Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda's objective is revenge, atrocities against the Muslims. Now, according to Al-Qaeda leadership, who are doing atrocities against the Muslims in the world? US or West against Arab Muslims, Israel. West is supporting Israel. Israel is doing atrocities against the Arab Muslims. India against Kashmiri. So for Al-Qaeda, US, West, Iran, India are enemy states. So they want to revenge. So its objective is revenge. Objective of Taliban is political control of Afghan. So they fought against the Soviet in 1989. Soviet left. One Soviet left. US also vacated Afghanistan without installing a democracy in this region. US also just left from this region. Cold War ended. 1991, US achieved the objective of containment of communism, but a civil war started here. Civil war between secular alliances of Afghan and Taliban. Now, US left, but India's interest lies with the stability of this region. So, civil war started between Afghans itself. These were fundamentalist Afghans who were fighting for Taliban, secular alliances who wants it. Their objective is Republic of Afghanistan. A secular democratic constitution. Okay. Adequate protection of the rights of minorities like Shias in Afghan, Sikh, Hindus who are living here. So their objective was this, and Taliban objective is Islamic state, Islamic Emirate. Their objective is Republic of Afghanistan. Okay. With a secular constitution, Taliban, Islamic constitution. In this civil war, India supported secular alliances. Even Iran supported secular alliances because they said we're going to give due protection to the minorities of Afghan. So Shias are also living in Afghan. Taliban fighters are Sunni Afghans. So they are ready to use violence against the Shias also. Anyone who is not following their version of Islam, according to them, is anti-Islamic. So Iran, India supported secular alliances, but Pakistan was supporting whom? Taliban. This was going on in our backyard after the end of Cold War. This war, this civil war took place for many years. And in 1996, Taliban came to power. From 96 till 2001, Afghanistan was under the control of Taliban. So when Taliban acquired the political control, suppression of minorities in Afghanistan. Okay, they banned art, culture, music. Tagging everything is Western. So you need to follow their version of Islam. Okay, so barbaric punishments on the name of blasphemy, religion. So they controlled Afghan through Iron Hand. Not only this, Islamic extremism seeped towards India also. Indian airline was hijacked at that time, and terrorists took that plane to where? Kandahar, Taliban, Afghanistan, Kandahar, which was under the control of Taliban. And anti-Indian government came to power in Afghanistan, which impacted the... So when anti-Indian government was controlling Afghanistan, this impacted India's national interest. I can't explain you what kind of interest it impacted, because things are too interrelated with each other. At least you can keep this thing in your mind. When Taliban came to power here and Taliban was governing Afghan, it impacted the core interest of our foreign policy. It impacted our core national interest. Taliban in power and violent extremism increased in India. Lashkar, Jaish and Hizbul. Terrorist camps in POK, Taliban started giving support to them. So India never recognized the government of Taliban. India used to consider Taliban as a terrorist group. But Taliban, government of Taliban got the recognition from Pakistan. For these many years, US did nothing. But dynamics changed in 2001 after 9/11. Okay, a terrorist attack on US, and US started a global war against terror. Okay. So this, now US started painting all these fundamentalist groups, that is Al-Qaeda, Taliban, with the same brush, that they are threat for world peace. Now, 9/11 act was not by Taliban. Taliban, the leaders of Taliban were controlling Afghanistan. Their only objective is political control and govern through laws of Sharia. It was by Al-Qaeda, the leader Osama bin Laden. So US put the blame for 9/11 on Al-Qaeda, and US projected that who is giving support to Al-Qaeda fighters? Taliban. They are running their camps from where? Afghanistan. Taliban is giving covert support to whom? Al-Qaeda. Where is Osama bin Laden hiding? Taliban. Though the leaders of Taliban refused, denied, we do not have Osama bin Laden in our country. Okay. In fact, they issued fatwa against this act of 9/11 that it was anti-Islamic, killing innocent civilians. But US never trusted these statements from Taliban, and US continuously warned Taliban, hand over Al-Qaeda and the fighters of, hand over Osama bin Laden and the fighters of Al-Qaeda, otherwise be ready for invasion from US, because we are going to start a global war on terror against the EU. Okay, so US, NATO started a war against Taliban. Okay, this was the time when India thought now US will going to be more strict, US will going to take more actions against Pakistan, because the hub of terror is Pakistan. But in this war, it was a shocker for India when US looked towards Pakistan for their war against the Taliban, and US started giving funding and weapons to Pakistan that help us in our war against the terror, that is Taliban. Okay. So the military of Pakistan projected that we are with you in your war against terror. But earlier, as I said, what serves the interest for Pakistan? Taliban in power within Afghanistan serves the interest for Pakistan, because this gives political depth to Pakistan. And China always wants Pakistan to have its depth here, because India is a competitor for China in Central Asia. Okay, but anyways, when US... why US was giving weapons and funding to Pakistan? Because US thought that it was the army of Pakistan who trained the fighters of Taliban. They have a better understanding of the terrain. Terrain is too complex in Afghanistan. They have a better experience. So the fighters of Taliban, they know better the terrain of this region. So US looked towards the army of Pakistan to support us in this war against the terror. Okay, but ultimately, I'm sure all of you are aware of this. Finally, where US was able to find Osama bin Laden? In Khyber Pashtunkhwa region. Now, the geography of this region is too much linked to the geopolitics of Afghanistan. How? Listen very carefully. These two regions, that is Fata and NWFP, Federal Administered Tribal Areas and Northwest Frontier Provinces, one of the provinces known as Khyber Pashtunkhwa or Pashtunkhwa of Pakistan, dominated by whom? Pashtuns. Society of Afghan is also dominated by whom? Pashtuns. Majority of Afghans are Pashtuns. Okay. So this region is also dominated by Pashtuns. Majority of the fighters of Taliban are Pashtuns. So Pashtun nationalism is a threat for the integrity of Pakistan. Pakistan is not realizing this. Pashtun nationalism is a threat for the integrity of Pakistan, because the Pashtuns of this region wants to integrate these territories of Pakistan with Afghanistan. Okay. That's why one of the sarcasm goes that where lies the solution of Pakistan? No Pakistan. India will take POK. Pashtuns will integrate with Afghanistan. Baluch will become independent country. Then there will be no Pakistan. These are the different dynamics we'll discuss later. Okay. But keep this thing in mind. Pashtun nationalism is a threat for the integrity of Pakistan. So this region is dominated by Pashtuns. So Pashtun nationalism is a threat for the integrity of Pakistan. And this region is dominated by Pashtun lords. They are governing these territories. These territories are not at all well integrated with the state of Pakistan. They have their own laws. So they are controlling, they have their own army. They are controlling a bit of territories under the control of one or the other Pashtun lord. And they are governing these territories through iron hands. These Pashtun lords. Okay. So this region not at all well integrated with the state of Pakistan. And these are the porous borders of Pakistan. Khyber Pashtunkhwa. Pakistan, since independence, has ignored the western borders. The sole focus is on the eastern border. So Pakistan has ignored the western borders altogether, invested all its energy towards the eastern borders, that is to deal with India. Okay. Now, these Pashtuns, so when US started a war against Taliban. Taliban lost the political control. Pakistan projected, we are with you in your war against the terror. They allowed CIA to conduct operations within Pakistan. CIA arrested many of the fighters of Al-Qaeda from Pakistan. Okay. Arrested Al-Qaeda fighters from Afghanistan. Though majority of the fighters of Taliban fled to Khyber Pashtunkhwa. Okay. So Taliban was pushed to the periphery. US was never able to completely defeat the Taliban. US only able to push Taliban back towards the periphery. And they entered into these regions and continued their guerrilla war against NATO and US forces. Okay. At that time, when US started a war against Taliban, Russia also supported the efforts of NATO against the Taliban, because Taliban, Islamic extremism, threat for Russia, and Taliban as a force was created to counter Soviet only. At that time, Russia was with the US. Now, when the fighters of Taliban, they lost the political control of Kabul and fled to these regions which are not well integrated with the state of Pakistan, the Pashtun lords of this region, they turned against the state of Pakistan. They blamed the state of Pakistan for doing things which are against Islam, or they are acting as the puppet of the West, and they are supporting West to defeat who? To defeat Taliban. Okay. So these Pashtun lords here, they turned against the state of Pakistan and they created a new organization called Tehreek-e-Taliban. Tehreek-e-Taliban. Now, Tehreek-e-Taliban started a war against the state of Pakistan. The group who shooted Malala Yousafzai. Attack on the Peshawar military school. By whom? Tehreek-e-Taliban. So they started a war against the state of Pakistan. So this Taliban, that is Tehreek-e-Taliban, which operates from Khyber Pashtunkhwa region, is bad Taliban for the state of Pakistan. Afghan Taliban, which is operating from Afghanistan, who is fighting against NATO, is good Taliban. Now there is no rationality to differentiate this. So if you think there is some rational ground they differentiate between good and bad, no, just pure. It is just on the basis of their interest. Afghan Taliban serves the interest of Pakistan. This is fighting with the state of Pakistan. That's why it's bad Taliban. And Afghan Taliban, who is in a state of war with NATO, is good Taliban. Though good Taliban and bad Taliban support each other, they are Pashtuns. So how ambiguous the objectives of Pakistan are. Now you will be amazed to know Lashkar Jaish, Hizbul, they are running their terrorist camps from the POK region with the support of the state of Pakistan. So Pakistan supports the terrorist camps against India. Now US was giving what? Funding and weapons to the state of Pakistan when they started their war against the Taliban. But covertly, state of Pakistan projected that we are with you because they were looking for $1 billion from US. But covertly, they were supporting whom? Afghan Taliban. So they started supporting Afghan Taliban. So weapons were coming from US to Pakistan. Pakistan was giving it back to Afghan Taliban, and they were fighting with whom? NATO. So a vicious circle created in this region. One of the main reasons why NATO has failed to defeat, or US has failed to defeat Taliban. Now, Pakistan supports Afghan Taliban. Pakistan was channelizing the funding for whom? Terrorist groups against India. This used to be one of the contentious issues between India and US. That what kind of global war against terror? What kind of, how you can say it's a global war against the terror or global war on terror? You are funding a state who is funding terrorism against us. It is you are only fighting against Taliban, because Taliban supports Al-Qaeda. So don't name it global war against terror, because if you are serious towards the global war against terror, you need to take action against the state of Pakistan rather than funding Pakistan. So India conveyed this thing many times to US. You cannot trust Pakistan because Pakistan's interest lies with Taliban, but US was ignoring. US was hoping, it was a hope against hope. Anyways, so this was the main reason, but this is the main reason why US has failed to defeat the Taliban, realized by Trump when Trump came to power. So it was the policy of Bush to take Pakistan on board in their war against terror. India warned against this, but US never listened to India. Then Obama came to power. Obama realized that Taliban can't be defeated. Okay, so Obama agreed for peace. But when Trump came to power, Trump said Taliban is a threat for world peace and Pakistan has given us fraud and deceit. So Trump decided to put sanctions on Pakistan. Now see the double standards of Pakistan. According to Pakistan, Afghan Taliban, the fighters of Afghan Taliban are mujahids. They are doing jihad against the aggressor. According to Pakistan, fighters of Lashkar Jaish and Hizbul, they are not terrorists, they are mujahids doing jihad against the state of India. But fighters of Tehrik-e-Taliban are terrorists. Despite all three have similar ideology. So Pakistan supports Lashkar. Pakistan is in a state of war with Tehrik-e-Taliban. But Lashkar Jaish Hizbul, they have hand in hand with each other. So that's why, according to India, how we can defeat Taliban, how Pakistan will defeat Tehrik-e-Taliban. Okay, for Pakistan, Tehrik-e-Taliban is a terrorist group. So according to India, how Pakistan can defeat Tehrik-e-Taliban? Till the time Pakistan will support Lashkar Jaish and Hizbul. That's why recently Rajnath Singh gave this statement. We are ready to support Pakistan in their war against terror. So support Pakistan in their war against terror means Tehrik-e-Taliban. But before that, Pakistan should stop giving support to whom? Terrorist groups against India. So understand the complexity of the issue. The state of Pakistan is trying to achieve something which is not possible. These are dichotomic interests which Pakistan is trying to achieve through this particular policy of supporting terror. Okay. So according to India, this policy is bound to fail. So Pakistan's only objective is to have its strategic depth in Afghan against India. And this is what China is looking forward to cut down India's influence in Central Asia, because India is a competitor for China. Anyways, so coming back to this, now let's compile everything. So Trump, US realized that, US said that when Trump came to power, Taliban is a threat for world peace and it is Pakistan who has given us fraud, who has given us deceit. So Trump decided to cut down all funding for Pakistan, and this brought India and US on the same table. Okay, but anyways, Trump said, I'm going to send more forces in US to defeat Taliban. But by that time, I'm not going to delve into the reasons now, but just keep this thing in mind. By that time, that is around after 2014 onward, Russia-US tensions escalated on the issue of Syria and on the issue of Crimea. As US, Russia and West, and the tensions with the West increased. As the tensions between West and Russia increased, Russia started feeling uncomfortable with the presence of NATO in this region, because Afghan is a extended backyard. So now Russia started feeling uncomfortable. So Russia decided to stop giving support to NATO against the Taliban. This changed the dynamics in this region, and this started serving the interest for Taliban. Trump also realized after 2 years in power that Taliban can't be defeated. So Trump agreed for peace with Taliban. Going back to 2001, when US defeated Taliban and Taliban was pushed to the periphery, at that time, the Republic of Afghanistan was established. US projected that we have installed democracy under Hamid Karzai, and later, who became the president of Afghan? Ashraf Ghani. So presently there is an elected leadership in Afghanistan. Though only 20% of the territory of Afghan is under the control of Afghan government. 80% of the control of Afghan is under the control of Taliban. So when Trump offered peace to Taliban, Taliban refused to sit with the elected leadership, blaming it as the puppet of the West. According to them, it's just a puppet government installed by the West to serve their interests. We do not recognize them. World was not ready to recognize Taliban. Taliban refused to recognize the elected leadership. So Trump said peace. Taliban earlier refused and later agreed to sit with the elected leadership on the condition that you will going to release the fighters of Taliban which are in the Afghan jail. So a prisoner swap deal was given by US and the Afghan government to Taliban, and Taliban has agreed for peace process with Afghan government. But the peace process is still going on, and at present the discussions are going on in Doha. What will be the outcome? It is still to be seen, because both the groups have entirely different objectives. As earlier I said, they want Islamic Emirate. Afghan government want Republic of Afghan. They want Islamic constitution. They want secular constitution. Adequate protection to minorities. So entirely different objectives to achieve for Taliban and Afghan government. Anyways, so US has agreed for peace with Taliban. US is ready to transfer power in the hands of Taliban, on the assurance that Taliban will not be going to support terrorist groups against the West. We have to see whether how things will going to unfold. Okay. So US agreed to offer peace. Trump said, okay, peace. And US agreed to negotiate directly with Taliban, bypassing the elected leadership. This shows only one thing, that US stand for it. US foreign policy is only to fulfill its own interests. US is not interested in stability and democracy. Way back in 1989, when Soviet defeated, US also left without bringing what stability, without installing the democracy. Civil war started. Then when Taliban started hurting the interest of US, US started a war against terror. Bring the Afghan government into power, bring these groups into power. But now, as they have realized Taliban can't be defeated, they have agreed to bypass the elected leadership and ready to negotiate directly with Taliban. Not acceptable to India, because India stands for Afghan led, Afghan owned. Okay, Afghan led, Afghan owned peace process. That you cannot bypass the elected leadership. In the peace process, all the two main stakeholders of Afghan should have a say. You cannot directly negotiate with the Taliban. This is the stand of India. Okay. Now, when US, let me compile things finally for you. When US agreed for peace process with Taliban, bypassing the elected leadership of Afghan, this has enhanced the political stature of Taliban. And US has again started looking towards the army of Pakistan to bring the leaders of Taliban on the discussion table. They have realized permanent peace and stability of Afghanistan is not possible without Pakistan. So one thing, enhanced political stature of Taliban, and this has given US himself has realized more important role for whom? Pakistan in the peace process. So this will going to impact India's influence within our backyard. Okay, so the probability has increased manifold. Who will going to be the major player of Afghan politics? Taliban. Somehow pressure is building on India to improve our ties with Taliban, because I started the lecture with this thing only. India wants pro-Indian government in Afghan. If anti-Indian government will come here, it will going to impact our national interests badly. Okay. One thing is access to Central Asia. Second thing is rise of Islamic extremism in our region. Okay. rise of Islamic extremism within this region. So US has started looking towards whom? Taliban. Now Russia also realized, Putin also realized, US has failed to defeat Taliban. Taliban will going to be a major player. So Russia already having tensions are already high between Russia and West on the issue of Syria and Crimea. So Russia wants to improve its ties with Taliban. And again, Russia is also looking towards whom? Pakistan. So that with the help of Pakistan, Russia wants to improve its ties with the leadership of Taliban. So again, the political stature of Pakistan has increased. One of the reasons for the present closeness of Russia and Pakistan. Okay, Putin has calculated Taliban will going to be a more important player. China already want Pakistan to have a strategic depth. Leadership of Taliban wants Pakistan to play a bigger role in the peace process. So this will going to impact India's influence. The reason why pressure is building on India to shed idealism and be more realistic and pragmatic in its foreign policy outlook, not to show inhibitions to improve our ties with Taliban when all the players are ready to negotiate and sit with the leadership of Taliban. India should not be more idealist, and we also need to find ways to improve our ties with the leaders of Taliban. Our strategic ally of this region, Iran. As tensions have increased between US and Iran, Iran is drifting towards Pakistan, China, and Iran also wants to improve its ties with Taliban. So you can understand from the discussion that Taliban will going to be a major player of Afghan politics in future. And in one line, if I have to compile things for you, is this: if India failed to improve its ties with Taliban, if India fails to improve its ties with Taliban, or if Taliban will going to remain anti-India, it will going to impact our national interest badly. Okay, so we have to see how things are going to unfold in future. Already, that's why we are making our present felt in Doha peace process. But India, as I said, India is committed towards India is really taking a firm stand towards what? Afghan-led, Afghan-owned, and Afghan-controlled peace process. I hope this will give you a bit of clarity about what exactly is going on within this region. Thank you.